We thank you for the rain that you're pouring over Kenya. And we pray, O Lord, that the Holy Spirit rain will fall over us even here in Moscow. That you reveal yourself, O Lord, to the people of the nations, that they may return to you and believe in you. We thank you, Lord, for what you're doing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Actually, there's a testimony. Apparently, as that rain was falling, or is falling, because it's still raining. It is still raining. Yeah, the rain is falling like it's on a mission, and it is. The rain is falling, and someone has been healed as the rain has been falling. How can it not bring healing? Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Let us read from the book of Revelation, chapter 3. So we continue with our letters in the book of Revelation. We have completed chapter 1 and chapter 2, haven't we?
Mm-hmm.
And we looked very deep on what the Lord is saying in these letters. And for the past 2 weeks, we have been talking about, are you there? Revelation. We've been talking about the prophecy that was released on the 15th of January about the coming of the Messiah, and how the prophet saw people wearing the same garment, having the same turban, all of them, they all looked alike with respect to their dressing. And we searched the scriptures to see where the Bible talks about the turban and the garment, and what does that mean? Amen? And we did find out that the turban represents, or is the imagery of the priesthoodness of the church. Yeah? That surely, when the Lord said, He has made us kings and priests, according to King James, or a kingdom of priests, it is indeed going to be fulfilled to the letter. That indeed those that are entering into the kingdom of God are the holy priesthood, 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And Zechariah chapter 3. And we read from the Revelation also, and the book of Matthew 22, where it talks about the need for the garment. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
That you cannot enter without this garment.
Mm-hmm.
And the prophet of the Lord, if you go to YouTube, he has given much extensive teaching on this garment, and I really encourage you to make time, especially during this holiday, to listen to those teachings on the garment. They are deep, long, maybe 3 hours teachings, but you see, you'll never get that anywhere else. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
So really make that investment, you will not regret it. So we continue chapter 3, from verse 1 to verse 6. Хорошо. I begin verse 1. Do you want to go in the second verse? And then so we go. Хорошо. Alright. Chapter 3 of Revelation. Verse 1. And to the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things says he who has the 7 spirits of God and the 7 stars. I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead.
Verse 2. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found your works perfect before God.
Remember therefore what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you.
Thou hast a few names even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy.
Hallelujah.
He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels.
Mm-hmm.
He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches.
Hallelujah. Amen. Very powerful. So again, when we began studying the book of Revelation, we said that the when we go back to chapter 1, the Lord said to John, the things that you see and the things that you hear, you must write down. And he says, and we said that, we understand that from the things he saw first in chapter 1, and the things he heard, from there came the message, a specific message to each of the seven churches that he was about to address. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
We said that, yes? And he mentioned a lot of things there. Three times he spoke, and three times he said the same thing in different ways, yeah? And we said, was he repeating himself unnecessarily? No. He was, in fact, speaking, putting a stress on this message that he spoke to the church, is it the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning of the second church in Smyrna, yes? And we said from these elements of what he heard and what he saw comes the message of exhortation to the church. Now, whatever the Lord was going to raise now, from there comes the message of exhortation, encouragement. From there comes the message of rebuke, yes?
Mm-hmm.
And from there also, what the Lord raised from what John saw and heard in chapter 1, from there comes the message of the promise to the church. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And when we read throughout the seven churches, as we are about to complete, you find that each church speaks a specific promise to each church. But in fact, we see that this promise is not just limited to one church. He's in fact speaking to the whole church of Christ. Amen? To the collective church of Christ, because the promise he speaks to the church in Ephesus is not only for the Ephesians. This is also a promise that he speaks to Hange. Amen? The promise he speaks to Smyrna and Thyatira is not just a promise that is for those churches, but also a promise for Mwali. Yes? Because this is your promise that you can literally hold on to and run with it. Amen? And run with it and get a hold of it in heaven. So when he speaks even here to Sardis, you hear that the message here is he's speaking to Sardis, but in fact he's also speaking to the church of Christ globally, because the problem is in Sardis is the problem in the church of Christ globally, especially in this hour. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, we can all relate to these things. Amen? Whether it's when he spoke to Thyatira about Jezebel, the false prophet, not only Thyatira, whether there was a false prophet, it's called Jezebel. Amen?
Yeah.
Today there are so many false prophetesses, lots of Jezebels in the church, just teaching people immorality and idolatry and the love of money and all these things. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Is it true? Yeah, it's very true.
Care.
They don't care. Just leading the sheep to hell.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Lord have mercy. No? So, and I pondered, I found it very interesting that you see when the Lord writes now to these churches, just imagine the Lord takes time to ponder, to analyze, to investigate each church that he writes to in these first two or three chapters. He takes time to analyze the church, amen, to probe, to study them and to find out what is their strength and what is their weakness. And what they should improve on.
Mm-hmm.
And to pen down a specific promise to each one of them.
Mm-hmm.
He speaks to each one of them, their conditions. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
He's not saying, and to the whole church. Of course, he's speaking to the church. But just the patience and the diligence he takes to write. And to the church of Thyatira. And to the church of Sardis. Now he's speaking to Sardis. And he says, you see, I have looked at you. I have observed you. And I have seen that you guys are having a pretense in your Christianity. You have an image of being alive. You see, he speaks to their specific condition. You have an image of being alive, but you are really dead. And then he rebukes them. Amen?
Amen?
The patience of the Lord. But now I couldn't help but think, but just try to imagine, if the Lord was to write a letter to you, How will it read? Or to the church of today? How will it read? And to the church of Christ in America? Or to the church of Christ in Russia? Or into the angel of the church of Christ in Russia? Right. I know that you have built many buildings and you are kissing their icons. What will he write? I know that you have grown too fat. Now that I've given you a lot of food, you don't even want to go to church. I don't know what he's going to write there. Huh? Now that I have blessed you with a keyboard, now you think you can use my keyboard to make money and forget about my worship. I don't know what he's going to write there. Eh? What do you think he's going to write there? You are so grown in the word, eh? No one can tell you what to do in the church. I don't know what he's going to write there. Pride, whether it's the issue of pride. Eh? And to the church of Christ in wherever. I have seen that you have compromised with the homosexual spirit. Now it's even on the pulpit. Now he was talking about Jezebel. He said, you have tolerated Jezebel. And then she was just aiming for the pulpit. And she got there. Now he says, now you have tolerated that Jezebel. And she brought in her immorality now. Now he is even naming it. Homosexuality. You have formed a pack. That you're so proud to hire homosexuals to come and teach. I don't know what he's going to write in that letter. So brief and concise, yet to the point. And very personal. Amen?
Amen.
And without ambiguity. Unambiguous as into what he wants to say. You know, sometimes if you're asked to write a letter, you try to just hit around the bush. No hitting around the bush here. Amen? Mm-hmm. Now here he says, Thyatira, let's talk. These things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Now, let's go back. When does he mention the seven spirits of God and the seven stars? Amen? Mm-hmm. Chapter 1, verse 16. We said, in chapter, yeah, so this, mm-hmm. this, so, in chapter 1, verse 16, comes the message to the church of Christ in Thyatira.
Sardis.
In Sardis. But this message also was spoken to another church. I think so. Sounds like.
The first one.
What did he say?
Ephesus.
Ephesus, yeah? Because here he says, these things says he who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. Two things now. The seven spirits of God and the seven stars. That's the message to Sardis.
Mm-hmm.
Ephesus is saying, these things says he who has the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. So, but now here he was talking about the golden lampstands and the seven stars. Here is the seven stars and the seven spirits of God. Хорошо? Mm-hmm. And he says in chapter 1, verse 20, he says, the seven golden lampstands, these are what? The seven churches. Now, what are the seven gold, the what? The
seven stars.
Yeah, the seven stars and the seven spirits of God. Verse 16. He had in his right hand seven stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun, shining in its strength. Amen? So, the message of the seven stars. What are the seven stars? Now, in verse 20 of chapter 1, it says the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. Amen? Okay. So, this is where the message is coming from. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
It says, in knowing, the message is coming from the one who has the seven stars in his hands. Amen? And the seven spirits of God. You know what the seven spirits of God are?
The ones in the Old Testament.
In the book of Isaiah.
Knowledge, fear.
In the book of Isaiah, he mentions the seven stars. Shall we go there? Seven stars, the seven spirits of God in it. Amen? Let's quickly turn to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah, allow me to use my a good friend here to help me. Search? Amen?
Mm-hmm.
It says the one who has the seven spirits. That means the seven spirits, the seven stars, these are the angels. That means these angels, they are in his authority. I mean, under his authority. Amen? He has the jurisdiction over these angels. And these angels, you know, they are stationed over every church. It means they report to him. And if you go to the book of Matthew chapter 18, he says, concerning the children of God, he said, he gives a warning, and in giving a warning, he reveals a secret of heaven. This warning says that be careful that you do not lead astray any one of these little ones. Because I tell you that their angels do what? Behold the face of the Father. That you find it in Matthew chapter 18.
Verse 6.
There it says, whoever receives one of these. Verse 10, yes? Take heed that you do not despise one of these little ones, for I say to you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. Amen?
Amen.
Now, let's go to Isaiah and look for the seven spirits of God. There's the spirit of
wisdom. Understanding? No? No, I'm guessing, I'm not sure.
The spirit of the Lord? Where is that one? You follow
fear?
Quickly.
In the book of Isaiah, chapter 11, verse 2.
Okay, chapter 11, verse 2. The spirit of the Lord?
Wisdom, understanding.
The spirit of wisdom?
Uh-huh.
The spirit of counsel and might? The spirit of knowledge?
Of understanding?
The spirit of the fear of the Lord?
And understanding also?
The spirit of understanding?
Mm-hmm. And the spirit of the Lord?
Yes.
Aye.
Okay, we went too fast. Number one, the spirit of the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
The spirit of wisdom?
Mm-hmm.
Spirit of understanding?
Mm-hmm.
Spirit of counsel?
Spirit of power?
Spirit of power, might?
Spirit
of knowledge? The spirit of the fear of the Lord?
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen.
Mm-hmm. That means these. When the spirit, when the sevenfold spirit of the Lord is in you, then we say you are truly alive. Okay, wait. These are the what? The sevenfold spirit of God. Amen.
Okay.
Now here he was speaking of this was a prophecy by Isaiah concerning the Lord Jesus and what kind of spirit was going to be upon him. Amen. And we read that in the book of Matthew chapter 3 and Luke chapter 3 when the Holy Spirit came upon him. What did it say? It said that when he came out of the water, the Holy Spirit of God came upon him like a dove. Amen? And Isaiah said, this spirit that is going to overshadow him, that will rest on him, is this sevenfold spirit of God. Amen? Хорошо? Now, when you go to the book of John, chapter 6, can we go there? Book of John, chapter 6. Hallelujah. That's Isaiah 11, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, John, chapter 6. Wait, time has run out. The book of John, chapter 6, verse 66, I think.
Sure.
The Lord when Jesus says, who gives life? Not 66.
Oh.
But it's somewhere there.
What was
the
book?
It is there in...
Oh, 63.
It is the spirit... 63, yes? Mm. Yes. I'm always confused this story. Хорошо. Verse 63. What does it say?
It is the spirit who gives life.
It is the spirit who gives life.
Mm-hmm.
The flesh profits what?
Nothing.
Nothing. The words I speak to you are
spirit
and they are life. Amen. So it says, the life, the spiritual life, for you to be considered spiritually alive in the spirit, spiritually alive in the kingdom, you must be filled with the sevenfold spirit of God. Amen? It says, when the Holy Spirit is in you, then you are truly what? Alive. Because it says, it is the spirit that gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The flesh receives nothing. The flesh benefits nothing out of it. It is the spirit who gives life. You must know that, okay? And then he comes to the church in Sardis and says, you have he says, this is the message of him who has the sevenfold spirit. Amen? Mm-hmm. Then he goes on to say, you have an image of being alive, but you are dead. Amen? You see where he's coming from? And then if you go to the book of John, now you understand how the message of the sevenfold that he says, why he needs to raise the issue of the sevenfold spirit. Amen? He's raising the sevenfold spirit here because the issue of life is what he's going to deal with here. Amen? Okay. Now, in John, he makes it plain. It is the spirit that gives life. The spirit, the flesh profits?
Nothing.
Now, go to the book of Romans chapter 8. Okay? We'll finish soon. Romans chapter 8. We read here Romans chapter 8 the other time. It says, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Mm-hmm. Who live after the what? Who live according to the Spirit. Huh? There is now no more condemnation to those who are in Christ. Mm-hmm. Amen? It says, to those who are in Christ, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free from the law of sin and death. For that which the law could not do, in that it was weak, through the flesh, God did by sending his Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. Mm-hmm. Amen? Mm-hmm. Condemned sin in the flesh. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. That the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. But now when you go down there, he talks about the mind controlled by the Spirit is life. Mm-hmm. You see it down there. Mm-hmm. But the mind that is controlled by sin is what? By sin is death. Mm-hmm. He makes that plain here in the book of Romans chapter 8. Hallelujah. Did you get that? For to be carnally minded is, that's verse 6, death. But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Amen? You get that? And then now he goes on down to address the issue. He says, verse 11, he says, let's start from verse 10 first. He says, and if Christ is in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the spirit is life because of righteousness. Hallelujah. Because now, remember at the beginning of chapter 8, he says, for that which the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by what? By condemning sin in the flesh. Mm-hmm. That says, for sin. Some translation. Condemn sin in the flesh. It says, that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now he says here, what? The Spirit is life because of righteousness. Now verse 11, he says, but if the Spirit of him who raised Christ from the dead dwelleth in you, mm-hmm. lives in you. Now he's speaking to us individually and as a church, yeah? Mm-hmm. Because he's addressing the Spirit, the what? The church in Sardis. And he's saying, they are dead. Amen? But we understand that message is indeed coming from the issue from the what? From verse 16 where he mentioned about the sevenfold spirit, the seven stars. From the sevenfold spirit. Now you see, for instance, when you are writing a command or an instruction to the army, if this instruction is coming from the from the commander of the army, mm-hmm. then you see the weight that it carries. Mm-hmm. But if that instruction is just coming from Julius, or if the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry was just allow me to use this example, I hope it has substance. Mm-hmm. For some financial issues to be executed, the instruction comes from the Ministry of Finance. Da? The Ministry of what? Of Agriculture cannot just say, hey, give us, you know, do some transaction there. It's almost more like that. He says, now, the one who holds the seventh spirit of the sevenfold spirit is speaking now. He needs to speak now because this church is dead. Amen? And now we are trying to understand, why is this church dead? Da? Amen? To understand what caused the death of this church. It has an image of being alive, but it is really dead. How come? And he can only see that because he is the one who holds the sevenfold spirit. Mm. Amen? Okay. The spirit that gives life is his. Mm. And he knows where it is and where it is not. Mm. Amen? You understand that? Mm. Yes. So he says, let's go back to Romans chapter 8, verse 11. It says, but if the spirit of him who raised Christ Jesus from the dead dwelleth in you, does yours say dwelleth?
Yes.
Dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies. Amen?
Amen.
Through his spirit who dwells in you. So we again see here that the life comes from the spirit. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
And in Revelation it says, it is the sevenfold spirit, the fullness of the spirit in you. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. That's why a church without Holy Spirit is a dead church. Amen?
Amen.
That's the image, that's the message that is coming out from here, mm-hmm. from you to you. Now, let's go back to Revelation. Huh? Or should I say, a Christian without his Holy Spirit is a dead Christian. Dead. You say, he is called a Christian, but he's truly dead. Because the Holy Spirit is not there. These things says he who has the seventh Spirit of God. Now, this helps us understand the message that is coming forth. Amen? And the seven stars. I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead. So you see, the problem with this church is the sevenfold spirit of God. Eh? Sevenfold spirit is absent. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
Is dead spiritually. But now, if the Holy Spirit is missing, then what's there? I think the book of Romans also answers our question because it says, for to be carnally minded is
death.
So you see what's there? There's carnality in this church. And the form of carnality here is the one that erases physical stuff. Maybe they have very good advertisement. When you go all over the town, it's just you see the Church of Christ in Sardis, all over the placards. They have so many placards, they do so many crusades. And the preachers, when they are preaching so fire and saliva is coming out of their mouths, they say, oh, this pastor is very powerful. But he's dead, he says. Yeah? Big buses with posters, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And when you go in the church, they're very nice, you know, he says, you have an image of being alive. The worship team is big with mini skirts and, you know. Amen?
Amen.
And money, and every time they close their service, they're saying, you know, they're talking about the financial prosperity, you know, principles.
Mm.
That if you want this message to work for you, if you want this message to work, just sow $1,000. If you sow $1,000, I tell you, you are going to have a breakthrough in your life. And if you give $50, then you receive a healing. He's saying, from the one who has the sevenfold spirit, you are dead. I have observed you. I have analyzed you, he says. I have probed you. Remember, in the second chapter, he writes to the church in Thyatira and he says, if you go down to the verse 20-something there, he says, and you will know that I am the one who searches, verse 23, yes? He says, verse 23, yes. And you will, they shall know, all churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and the hearts. He says, and I will give to each one of you according to your works. That means even for Thyatira, he searched perfectly their hearts and their minds. And in fact, you cannot hide anything from the Lord, can you?
No.
No. The Spirit is his. The Spirit that heals is his. The Spirit that gives knowledge, understanding is his. Then that means when he looks at this church, go to Isaiah, he says, he looks at this church and he sees the Spirit of the Lord is missing. Done? The image is there. They're very nice designs, yeah? And a big television show where they invite all, even secular artists to sing. He says, they're very, 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 you know, the image is good. Done? It's like one preacher I was listening to a long time ago on TV, and he says, you know, some preachers, they are like this boy who was given an announcement, an assignment to do from the university, yeah? Given an assignment. Maybe say, for instance, he was asked to do an assignment on Streptococcus. He went and did an assignment on Staphylococcus. Yeah? That's just my example.
Mm-hmm.
And then when he did a very nice, thorough article or whatever, assignment, and hands it in. And the professor marks, very good content, good structure, very good fonts, whatever, da? Very neat work, but wrong assignment. F, circled. And that pastor said, even when some of these churches, they go to the gates of heaven, it's a big church, lots of church members, very good organ in the church. Da? You know, it's an organ, it's a very powerful keyboard, I mean, piano with about 3 layers and a lot of things there. Now, he says, very powerful, very big church, crystal glass, you know, tall building and television show, but wrong assignment. That's the message to Sardis here. Everything powerful, or so it seems. Now, it looks powerful, but dead. I think we have to finish this next time. Yeah? We finish this next time. I know your works. That you have a name, that you are alive. So you have an image that you are alive. But you are dead. May that not be what the Lord will write about us.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen.
I know he's writing even, I know this message is even to a lot of churches right now. And there are a lot of things in the church right now. A lot of love for money. Immorality, homosexuality, name it. So many things in the church today. And that is a perfect image that the sevenfold Spirit of Christ is what? It's not, it's missing. Wisdom, absent. The Spirit of the Lord, absent. The Spirit of understanding, absent. The Spirit of power, absent. The Spirit of the fear of the Lord, absent.
Counseling.
The Spirit of counsel, absent.
Understand
the Spirit of understanding, absent. It's just, then he says, for to be carnally minded is dead. That means carnality has taken over this church. Now they are working with the philosophy of mankind. No wonder the prophets say sometimes, he says, the church relies these days on what? Philosophia de humanos. He says, the church today relies on human philosophy. The church today relies on psychology. Oh, don't preach a powerful, don't rebuke sin, because if you rebuke sin, people, they know they are psychologically unstable. If you rebuke immorality, you know, they are going to walk away. They cannot handle such a message. It's too much for them. They are going to be stressed out. They've been through a tough economic crisis, you know. So if you preach that kind of message, Just tell them the Lord loves you. He's a very good God. He doesn't condemn you. The Lord doesn't want you to feel sad. The Lord wants you to live every day like it's a Friday. You know, the Lord, you know, the Lord really doesn't matter how you dress, you know, just come as you are. And indeed, we must come as we are. But over time, you know, there must be a change, you see. Mm-hmm. 10 years and you're born again, you're still wearing miniskirts. Oh, what a message. Yeah? 10 years you're born again, you're still calling yourself homosexual. Eh? Ah, you're not born again. Yeah. Ah, ain't no born again here. Amen? Ain't born again. 10 years and still just, you know, married but living with someone else. Ah, 10 years. You're saying you're born again. No, here. The sevenfold spirit of Christ is missing. Amen? Missing. Absolutely missing. Because you can see that the fear of the Lord is absent. Father, we thank you for the word today. We thank you that you really helped us today to understand your message to the church in Sardis. And I pray, Lord, that our church, that this devotion shall not receive such a letter. Help us, O Lord, to be indeed filled with the sevenfold spirit of Christ. Even in our churches, O Lord, help us, O Lord, that indeed we may rely on you, Holy Spirit, and not on carnality. Help us, O Lord, to be fixed on you, Father. Help us, O Lord, to be fill us with the Holy Spirit and cleanse out every carnality from us, from our churches. Cleanse out every carnality, O Lord. Set us free from the flesh, from sin. Remove this hypocrisy, O Lord, that we may be truly alive in you. That we may be truly filled with the Holy Spirit of Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.